Hello and welcome to today's webinar from the Societies of Photographers. Today's webinar is Changing the Perception of Pet Photography with Maria Michael, ASWPP, which is proudly sponsored by Sony and supported by London Camera Exchange. Maria has been a professional photographer for over 10 years, and whilst her business covers a variety of photographic genres, it is her specialist pet photography, which she has such a passion for, that has made her notoriety. So welcome back to the webinar series, Maria. It's lovely to have you back.
Hi, thanks, Colin. Thanks for having me again.
It's amazing. The last presentation, which was a members-only one we did, was a really interesting presentation about pet photography. And I know this one's going to be just as good, you know, so interesting about this kind of genre that I know you've got such a passion for. So we're really looking forward to it.
That's great. Thanks, Colin.
And Mark, thank you so much for supporting us again, and to London Camera Exchange for supporting the webinar. We really appreciate Sony's support you've given the webinar series, and we've had some fantastic webinars over the past year. And I know this will be another amazing one. So, you know, welcome back, Mark, and thank you to Sony for supporting us again on the webinar series.
No, absolute pleasure, Colin, and thank you, Maria, as well, for doing this for us as well. And yeah, I'm looking forward to it. And yeah, thanks for the opportunity. Good to be here again.
So to anyone tuning in, obviously this is all about changing the perception of pet photography with Maria. So if you do have any questions, then please do post them in the comments. You know, we're here to make this a really interactive one. If you've got any questions on Sony kit, then Mark is here to support you with that as well. So, you know, please do fire your questions. Maria's got a fantastic presentation lined up for you, but do fire those questions in. We want to make it really interactive and help you guys out that are tuning into the live session today. So without further ado, let's bring up your presentation. And if you're happy, we'll get the presentation going. Right. As usual, me and Mark will be in the background here to support you. So we're really looking forward to it.
Thank you, Colin. Hi, Mark. Thanks for having me here. Hi, everybody. So yeah, welcome to this webinar all about changing the perception of pet photography. Introduction for those of you who don't already know me. My name is Maria Michael. I'm a Greek Cypriot. I'm British. I've lived here all my life. I'm a wife, a mother, an animal lover, and I love to travel. So it's me and my family. I think we're in Bali then, so a couple of years ago. And boy, do I miss traveling at the moment. So I'm a specialist pet photographer. I have been for over 10 years. And although I've done lots of different things within my photography business and lots of genres, like Colin said, about 2 years ago, I started to streamline things down so that pet photography, commercial photography are the kind of key things that I do. So my commercial work is predominantly around animals, in the sense of I've done work for big veterinary groups, for veterinary insurance companies. I've done books for people who are writing about, so there's one there that's called Riding Pain Free. So it's, we did a lot of work with horses and stuff for a book that's coming up. But I have also done things like where I've ended up in the middle of the sea photographing shipwreck containers and things like that. So yeah, food, you name it. And also I'm a speaker and trainer. You'll see me at the Society's convention quite a few times, or at the photography show. I've done work for some colleges, and I've been in Cyprus, I think it's about 2 or 3 years running now, where I've ran workshops and training sessions for small groups, like that one on the beach that you can see there. And I guess for me, why I like doing my webinars and public speaking and stuff is because I'm so passionate about what I do. And I want to be able to share that with everybody in the hope that people see pet photography maybe, hopefully, in a different light to what they already see it in, and learn to appreciate and respect this genre maybe in a way they hadn't thought about before. So early influences in life before pet photography, or photography as a whole, really, because if you'd asked me 20 years ago, would I be a professional photographer, I think I would have laughed and thought, oh, don't be so silly. Me? I didn't really know. So I grew up, and my favourite TV programmes were like The Littlest Hobo, I don't know if anyone's old enough to remember that, and Lassie, I think many people know Lassie, Black Beauty, and The Horse Whisperer. And the man himself, Mr. Monty Roberts, who's the real Horse Whisperer, was always someone that I found quite inspirational, really, and his ethos and his attitude towards the connection with horses is something that I think I'm quite intrigued about, and would love to think that I try to replicate as much as possible with all animals, especially the ones I work with. So when I grew up, my parents were both born in Cyprus and subsequently came here to England and actually met when they're in England. But they both grew up on farms. So I used to get told all these stories about animals as a child and kind of the antics they got up to and things that were going on. But they were very much, you know, in Cyprus, very much like outdoor. Everything was outdoor. So all the animals lived outside. The dogs lived outside, everything. You didn't have a dog in the house and stuff. But my uncle's from my mum's side, he had a farm and he had lots of goats and ducks and chickens and horses. So I loved spending time there, not necessarily doing anything more than just being with the animals. But I found that really, for me, that's my world. I just loved doing that. And my father was obsessed with wildlife programs and Westerns. So I've watched more Westerns than I can think of. But also wildlife programs. I think there's one by Disney where there's a scene with a meerkat where it's calling the others over. And I must have watched that about a million times as a child. And when my kids were born, when my dad was still alive and he was quite bedbound for a long time, he would make them watch the same movies. It's quite entertaining, really. And at home, we had rabbits, hamsters, and eventually we got a dog. But my mum and my dad really worked long hours. So having animals was quite challenging for us because there was no real adult presence around to care for them very much. But I started my formal riding lessons as a teenager and I absolutely loved it. My favorite thing was jumping and going out on hacks so that I could gallop. But I think I drove my instructors crazy because I was not very, I didn't listen a lot. I should just want to run around like a loony. So in fast forward sort of thing to 1997, sorry, we got married, Mike and I got married, and we had Theo, our eldest, in 2002, and then Demi in 2004. I was a senior social worker by then. I'd been a nursery nurse. And then I was a senior social worker dealing with high-end court cases, basically, sadly, battered baby cases and things like that. But in 2005, whilst I was working as a senior social worker, I was visiting a client in Hereford when I was assaulted by another resident. I didn't realize I was going to do that. Oh, that's it. And then the initial injury I sustained lasted probably about 2 months. But then over the next 12 months, I started to develop really weird physical and cognitive symptoms, which really affected my work and my personal life. And then by 2008, I was forced to medically retire, which is a really weird feeling for me. I lost my career. I lost my financial stability. I'd always been earning since the age of about 15. My car, and I kind of lost my identity because I wasn't very academic, so I worked really hard to become a social worker and to gain a really good reputation in what I did. And then I felt like I'd lost it overnight. And I was only 33 years old, so it was kind of a really big blow for me and for my family, but for me psychologically, I think. So I live with something called fibromyalgia and few other bits and pieces, but my kind of, it's hard because there's a lot of symptoms, but the kind of I wanted to give you kind of an overall. So I have a lot of stiffness, muscle ache and stuff, confusion and memory problems, something known as brain fog. It is quite funny, I have to say, when your children have learned to use that to their advantage. So my kids will say, oh mom, you know, we did tell you, but you do forget. And I'm like, yeah, okay, don't try that one. I get severe chronic fatigue, so some days getting out of bed is like the hardest job in the world. And then there's other days when I do things and people look at me and think, what, why, how has she got so much energy? Don't ask me because I don't know. There's no rhyme or reason to it. It is one of the most weirdest conditions. I do slur my speech sometimes, so I'm sorry if I do that during the talk. It is all to do with the way my brain sends signals and the way they're received by my body. I was also diagnosed with a sleep disorder called idiopathic hypersomnia. So don't get excited. All it means is excessive daytime sleepiness of no known cause. So basically, unlike narcolepsy, I don't nod off. I just feel really sleepy all the time. So I'm medicated to stay awake, which is an interesting one. My brain forgets to tell my body to breathe. I think this is probably one that took me a while to clock onto, but it makes a lot of sense now when you see your symptoms. So my body will go into like an anxiety attack because it's having a lack of oxygen. But because I now know that, I can kind of talk myself through it. But in the early days, that was really weird. I'd be walking down the road and suddenly I'd feel really anxious and start to get like panic symptoms. And I wouldn't know why because nothing had happened yet. So it's really weird. I also get really sudden drops in blood pressure where it causes fainting and collapsing. I'm really lucky that I've got on top of that now and I've managed to kind of understand signs, early signs, warning signs. And but I do, sorry, Colin, but a society's convention is like the one place where it normally happens, because I spend most of my time running around seeing everyone and forgetting to eat when I should, and, you know, keep my fluid intake up. And it has its positives. I met Audrey Kelly like that. We've become the closest of friends, but I met her because I blacked out in the toilets, I think it was. So it has its advantages sometimes. And yeah, it has a significant impact on my mobility. And I think one of the biggest challenges is learning to live with a hidden disability. When you look normal, I say that in inverted commas if you can't see me, it's really difficult because people, sometimes you think people think that you're making things up or that you're over-exaggerating. And sometimes because it's physically not visible to other people, you almost feel uncomfortable to mention it. And it is a real, it messes with your brain really a lot. And it took me a long time to realize I didn't need to worry about what other people thought. I needed just to cater for myself. And if people didn't believe what I was saying or thought I was lying or, you know, over-exaggerating, well, tough luck, really. Not to care, because you spend too long worrying about what they're thinking and you're not dealing with your own needs. And I think that's a big turning point for me. But it meant discovering a new me, because the me that used to jog 4 miles every morning before going off or doing a 24-hour shift as a social worker, you know, when I was doing residential work, and then coming back and going to the gym 4 times a week, that was not me anymore. Couldn't do that anymore. In fact, getting out of a chair was a struggle. So I had to find out who the new me was. So we'd already had 2 dogs before, but in 2009, we we took on Harvey, who was this French Mastiff cross boxer, because he was my guilt trip to keep walking, because walking was becoming a little bit of a problem and it was looking like I'd end up in a wheelchair. So by walking, believe it or not, I actually kept my mobility up much better. And I decided to train myself. So I spent a lot of time reading and watching documentaries and stuff and videos about not so much the training side, but more the psychology side of working with dogs, but also a bit of the training side. I wanted to be able to do something to keep myself active. And it was great. He was fitted with a GPS collar, a special collar, which is actually an anti-theft collar, but it runs on GPS and it has a panic alert. So I can press this button and it would send Mike and whoever else's number I programmed in a text message. And when they got that text message, if they opened it up, they could track me live on Google Maps. And it really gave me the confidence to go back out on my own again, because when you can randomly black out in the middle of nowhere, with little warning, it was quite scary. And actually, it really gave me a lot of confidence. So it really helped. And at the time, I wanted to keep myself busy because I've never been a person that isn't busy. I like to be doing things. So I started taking more photos. I've always taken photos, but more for reference of memories of people and places. But I started to do that more and more and make things. I just started faffing around. I'm quite creative, so I started making things. And I started making these greeting cards more for people that we knew. And I say a meeting with fate, because it really was. The kids' primary school had a Christmas shopping event. And I went along with my little table and I put these cards out. And this lady walked over and she said to me, "Wow, they're amazing. Do you do that with people's own pets?" And I don't actually know why I said what I did, but I think maybe I got a bit of an invisible nudge somewhere. And I went, yeah, that's what I do. And she says, "Oh, wow, that's amazing. So what do? Do you like come out and meet us on a walk and take photographs?" And I was like, and I just kept nodding, going, "Yeah, that's exactly it." Thinking, what a great idea. What a lovely job. And she said, "Well, how much do you charge?" And I said, £20. She went, "Is that all?" And I literally thought, oh, my God, I should have said more. But it was literally, that was the seed that changed everything. Obviously, a lot's happened since then. But it was the seed of which everything grew from. And that's why I say it's a meeting with fate, because I didn't know the woman. I'd never seen it before. I'd never even seen it at school before. And it was just pure fluke. So, and that was the beginning of Ditheo. It was Ditheo photography, and now more so Ditheo specialist pet photography, obviously. So why pet photography? Well, animals have played a vital role in my life. They've been there for me in my darkest hours, not just through the disability, but through other things as well. And they've really helped me through, that bond that you have, that connection that you have, is very much an innate connection. And when you're going through very difficult things, they are so therapeutic without even realizing it. Even research has shown that stroking animals you know, lowers your stress levels and stuff anyway. But those people who really have a close connection with their animals will tell you it's, they are very therapeutic in their own right. I'm fascinated about that ability to build that strong connection between species. So the fact that a human who statistically is more primate, and the way, you know, if you see me, I always my hands and stuff like that. We work a lot on body language and stuff, but we're all arms, aren't we, and all hands and stuff, that we can connect so amazingly well with this, you know, this canine, this hunter, or with horses, or with, you know, or felines or cats, you know. And whilst we don't speak the same language, in inverted commas, we do actually have a way of communicating where we can build up this strong bond. And it's, I find it really fascinating. And I'm also really sort of like, I don't know, fascinated, intrigued, have a lot of respect for the significant role that animals play through human history and through to the present day, and how much, if you stop and look at it, they're integrated into our everyday lives, or to a lot of people's lives. And for me, all of that really means that I'm quite, it makes me quite passionate about being able to capture those important memories for my clients who equally have that kind of passion about their connection with their pets. So when we talk about animals' roles in human lives, when we talk about, I mean, I say dogs and horses, but don't get me wrong, there are lots of other animals, believe it or not, like even pigeons, that have been involved in a lot of this stuff. But, you know, you've got your guide dogs, your hearing dogs, you've got medical detection dogs. I've watched a dog guide a child back to a stand at Crufts because she needed to have her insulin. And the dog could smell that chemical change. It's phenomenal. You've got dogs that smell cancer. I think they've trained dogs now to sniff out coronavirus. So it's an amazing thing they can do. It's something they do naturally, and we teach them to home into that. But their influence on our lives, their impact on our lives because of that is really, really big. So working farm horses, therapy horses and therapy dogs, dogs and horses used in the world wars. I mean, millions of animals. What is it? 8 million I've got there. Horses, donkeys and mules died in just World War One. You know, 850 guide dogs are trained each year in the UK alone. It's a phenomenal amount. You've got guard dogs, ranch horses, sniffer dogs, coal mine ponies, pets as therapy, list goes on. So that entwinedness of our lives, I find it really, really fascinating. And especially when you come to current day and you look how many dogs are in shelters and how many horses, if you go to horse sanctuaries and see how, you know, how many horses are suffering and stuff, it's quite amazing really to see how we can jump from this need and this important relationship to suddenly these animals that are suffering and neglected. So for me, when I was setting up the company, I had my ethos, and my ethos was that I wanted my company to maintain the same values that I held for every part of my life. It was honesty, reliability, individuality, and a sense of self. I have never aspired to fit any mold in life, and I do not want my business to either. So rather than replicate what had already been done, I decided to create a service that was completely unique, to create not only stunning photography, but images that held a special deeper meaning for our clients, images that they would instantly emotionally connect to. Now, people would assume that you take a photo of someone's animal, they're going to connect to that picture, but it goes far deeper than that. So what I talk about a lot, and I probably mention it later on again in the slideshow, is this thing of your subconscious. And as someone who shares a life with animals, every single day of my life, predominantly, I go out walking with Wilson, who is in that picture. And we might cover 2.5 to 3.5, maybe even 4 miles in that morning. And those things that I'm walking past, the woodlands, the fields that I'm walking through every day, my brain is storing those memories as a subconscious memory. I don't think about it. I don't necessarily reflect on them unless I talk about it like now. But in photography, when a client sees an image of a place that their brain has stored subconsciously time and time again, they have an immediate connection to that image, where you might see just woodlands in the background, some blurred trees that don't mean anything. For them, their brain feels familiar and comfortable and warm and welcoming. And those are the images for me that are key. Because fast forward 10 years on, 15 years on, when these animals are gone, the ability to evoke so much from that image is phenomenal. The thought process that you go through when you relive that walk, the sounds, the smells, what the experiences you shared there, is so powerful. And that's what that photograph can do. So it's really key that the images that I capture aren't just beautiful pictures, that they are beautiful pictures within that right setting that are very personal to the person I'm working with at the time. So equipment, which is obviously a key thing as a photographer, especially when you're running a business. So I have an essential non-camera kit that I live by. On left and right, you have two pairs of boots. Now you may laugh, but boots are an important part of my life. So on the left, we have my Dr. Martens boots, my industrial boots. These are the ones that I wear to shows. And they're the ones that I'll wear if I'm not walking a lot of miles, but going to be in close contact predominantly with horses because they're still toe caps. And if I need a pair of boots that are rugged and stuff, but I know I'm not going to be traipsing through, like, you know, 4 miles of woodland, then I'll tend to wear those. And often in the office, I'm wearing those. On the right-hand side are my muck boots. I wear those boots every single day, winter and summer, and on most of my shoots, other than if I'm wearing my other boot, my industrial boots. But usually I'm wearing the muck boots because they're so comfortable, and they've got neoprene on the calf, so they allow you to bend a lot. So I know that my feet are dry and comfortable, and I can hike over 4 miles, and, you know, it's not a problem. I don't care what I'm treading in, and I have trodden lots, you know, cow poos, for example. So they're great. My camera bag, again, I can't have things resting on my shoulders long. So my camera bag I've tried so many bags. I've had sling type bags, I've had all different types, and this camera bag has been the best. It's not huge, but it's big enough to accommodate my kit for what I would take with me. It also has traveled around to various countries with me, so it's done hiking through Malaysian jungles and been out to Borneo and stuff, and it's been out to Bali. Every holiday I go on, because all my camera kit goes with me on the airplane, it's in there and it goes with me. So it's traveled a lot and it's lasted really well. And then my Spider Holster Pro, which I go nowhere without, even on holiday, because it means I don't carry shoulder straps. My camera's on my hip at all times. And it means that I'm not putting a camera down. When I used to do wedding photography, I used to put the camera on the table to do something, forgetting that someone could just walk past and swipe this camera. So the Spider Holster Pro has been brilliant, but it also takes the weight off of my shoulders. I could never have a shoulder strap with a camera. So it means that it's there. And I actually have climbed a mountain wearing that Spider Holster. So it's doable. And then the Spider Holster hand strap, for people like me who've got bad hands, it's really useful to have like a kind of added security, let's say, in case I let go of the camera, which has been known to happen. Now, my old camera kit, I started off with the D700, the Nikon D700. I actually went to the shop and someone said to me, you need to hold these cameras and see what you think. And I did. And I fell in love with the D3S at the time. This is many years ago. And then saw the price and went, oh, okay, I can't afford that. So the D700 was my next choice. And I loved it. It was brilliant. And then I managed to get the D3S quite a few years ago now, secondhand from a lovely photographer called Goodvere, who's one of the society's members as well. And the two of those cameras, you know, were great. And I had my 70-200 and my 24-70. And for me, on my everyday kind of work, so not studio work, not show work, that's all I need, because that's genuinely all I would use. And actually, 95 to 98% of the time, I'm using my one camera body with the 70-200, because that's the lens that I work best with. So they, you know, I had those cameras for many years. Technology moves on, you know, new things were coming out, but because my cameras seemed to be doing what they were doing and doing it well, I kept with them. But I started to notice more and more issues for me personally. So the first one was size and weight. And whilst the D700 was quite compact when used without a battery grip, the D3S was quite hefty. This was also the same for the lenses. When you added the 70-200 to either of those cameras, they became quite heavy combinations. So when you're working on location, it meant that I was carrying not only the two camera bodies and lenses, but also having to shoot whilst in really strange positions. So literally, a lot of times I'm lying on the floor in a shoot, but there have been times where I had to climb down the side of a bridge to get into the right position for a particular shot of this. There's one of a lady running through water with her horse, And in order to get to the point where I needed to be to catch this shot when she was running through, I had to climb down this bridge. So the bigger the equipment, the harder that becomes, and the heavier the equipment. And the other thing was that obviously the heavier the equipment, it was harder for me to keep my hands steady because of the condition that I have. And muscle fatigue kicks in really fast. So the heavier your equipment is, the quicker that fatigue is kicking in, and it's making it harder and harder for you to keep on top of. The autofocus and the tracking, both the 700 and the D3S had great autofocus and really good low light capabilities for their time. And in fact, I think the D3S was actually launched as a professional sports photographer's camera because it was like the one deemed for great action shots and stuff. But my problem was that in order to achieve those sharp images of animals running towards me at high speed, I'd need to be agile enough to maintain the focus point on the subject. Now, when an animal's running parallel to you, like a pannon effect, it's slightly easier because the depth of field doesn't change as much. When they're running towards you, and animals never run, especially dogs, they don't run with their head in the same place. They're bobbing up and down like yo-yos. So you need to be agile enough. And honestly, my arms, especially if I'm in a lying position, I just couldn't get my shoulders to move properly. So it's becoming quite an issue for me more and more. The other thing was the shutter sound. Now, if you work with really nervous animals, or if you're a wildlife photographer, you'd know this, you know, you don't really want that sound going off. When you're working with continuous shutter as well, to go like a machine gun, it's even worse. So it kind of, you know, it was a problem to start with, obviously, but it just, I used to notice it more and more. And as my reputation grew for working with nervous and reactive animals, I was working more and more with those animals. So I was seeing the issue more and more. Technology, you have to remember both these cameras were launched around 2008, 2009. And technology within the industry obviously has moved on rapidly since then. And I've never been the one to chase technology blindly. And I say that because cameras were coming out all the time, but you know, if it ain't broke, don't fix it kind of mentality works for me. And also you definitely don't see other professionals quickly changing their equipment just because there's a new one out. Because you use something that does the job that you want it to do. And that's really important. And I've seen the aftermath of people upgrading the camera and realizing, the file sizes are much bigger than I thought. And now I need a new hard drive and new computers. And, you know, for me, as long as it does my job, the job I need to do it and do it well, that's what's key. However, the quality of the camera sensors, the autofocus, the active tracking, the lenses, they're so much more advanced now that there comes a stage where you say, okay, my cameras were doing a good enough job then, but actually there are cameras that are doing that job much better and much easier for me personally to deal with. And one of those is my memory. I have a huge issue every day with remembering the most simplest of things, but on a bad flare-up day, it's lethal. And I can remember being on shoots and shooting away and then realizing that I'd actually forgotten to adjust my settings for the changes in lighting, you know, where the sun pops out from behind the clouds or things like that. And yeah, you know, I put there, you would think this is the most basic thing for a pro to remember. But if you just have to think, I forget to breathe. So if I forget to breathe, changing your camera settings, well, that's really far down the line, you know? So it's easy for me to forget those things. What you're seeing in the viewfinder is not what you're going to take as a photo. It's even easier. So I would forget to look at that little bar at the bottom that's showing my exposure. So I knew for a long time there was a time for change, but it's scary to change because change isn't something that I particularly love. And I had previously spent a lot of money, thousands, on an Olympus system, which seemed to be really promising. And in a studio environment, actually was fine. But it turned out not to be suitable for the way that I work personally. And thankfully at that time, I had held on to my Nikon kit. I was very close to handing it in, but I didn't. I kept it. And I'm really grateful I did, because I had to go back to my Nikon kit within, it was less than a year. But I still wanted to look more towards a mirrorless camera this time, but I wanted one that was full frame. And I knew there was quite a few to choose from. So I thought the best thing to do was to actually speak to somebody who used a similar system, but also would understand the issues that I would face in terms of the action photography to start with. So in January last year at the convention, I was really fortunate enough to speak to an amazing photographer called Terry Donnelly, who's a sports photographer, but he also does these photos of wild squirrels, which is really challenging. And it sounds really easy, but it's not, because squirrels, oh my God, they're so fast and erratic. And, you know, that is literally the kind of work that I do, just not with squirrels. So we chatted for ages and we talked through the system, and it's actually, I got to realize that that system actually was really not only great for the way that I would work, but I was beginning to think it was actually gonna be really good for me on an individual level for my disability and stuff. So he kind of introduced me to Mark. I told you, get a look in Mark, who was manning the Sony stand at the trade show. And Mark was really kind and spent ages talking to me and listening to my concerns and about the requirements that I had. And one of my things was it was going to be a huge financial investment. And I didn't want to get it wrong again. You know, I didn't want to do the same thing I did last time. So I decided to save up and plan to change over to Sony completely, everything, by May that year. But of course, we had a pandemic. And that had other ideas and scuffed up what I wanted to do. So I had to accept the change. I had to accept that the change would have to wait. It'd be gradual and take longer. So it was not until August last year that I was able to get my first camera body, the Sony A9 camera body, and the 70 to 200 mil, because they were that was the combination that I knew I would use most all the time. So when I had the odd few shoots that we could get in last year, I would always take my Sony kit, so my Sony with my lens, but I'd have a Nikon and a Nikon lens in my bag as a backup. But I would just shoot with my Sony as I, you know, that combination that I would always shoot with. So now this is my current kit, excuse me. So I have the Sony A9, the Sony 70-200 f2.8, and the Sony 24-70 2.8. Other than another camera body, which hopefully won't be too long, that is it. That's all I need. Now, I may get other lenses because I would like to get them to have for other things I do as project work, but I don't need anything else. Because for the majority of the work that I do, that is all I need. And it serves me well. So I don't need to be buying extra stuff for the sake of it, because then you realize you spent money and you don't actually need what you're spending your money on. So how moving to Sony has impacted my work? Well, the weight of the equipment has massively reduced, thank God, which means that carrying it for hours, hiking across many miles during a shoot is much easier. And it's more compact, which means I can accommodate it much easier in my bag. And this is a huge bonus when I travel for work, especially abroad, because like I said, I always take my equipment with me as hand luggage. Before, I took my hand luggage, camera equipment, and Mike had anything else I needed, like my wires, my tablets, my Kindle, was all in his bag because I could not fit anything else in. Whereas now I have loads of room in my bag. The autofocus is really fast and accurate, which means almost every shot is sharp. And if it's not, it's usually my fault. With 20 frames a second, it means that I can confidently capture the images that I want in a running sequence. Now, when I edit my photos, in that running sequence, a lot of those images I don't want to use, but it's in a certain point that the image comes in that I want to use. And it's all to do with the way the body is and how many feet on the ground and stuff like that. And having those 20 frames a second means I don't miss that. Whereas before, sometimes I would have missed that shot. Silent shutter is brilliant for nervous animals or wildlife, but it just equally for any time, you know. Wedding photographers, the last thing you want is, especially not in a church or a ceremony, it just sounds really bad. So it's great. Although sometimes at the beginning, I didn't know I was taking photos, which is quite funny. And my daughter still says to me, have you taken that photo yet? And I'm like, that took loads. I said, really? Because she can't obviously hear anything. Subject tracking is brilliant and staying focused on the subject, on the selected subject. And the continuous focus is excellent at calculating the speed of the subject to maintain that sharpness. It is really... people think it's really easy, but it's not. Not a lot of cameras do this well. When an animal's running towards you, the camera has to calculate that speed and to ensure the sharpness of that animal's moving, exchanging its depth of field. And so keeping that sharpness throughout that, those calculations have to be done by the camera. And some cameras just don't do them very well. Sony A9 definitely does them very well. I cannot fault it. It's brilliant. And larger files allow for more flexibility with cropping. Now, I don't say take just any shot and then crop in, but when you're working the way I do, very free flow, you don't really have, I don't have any control over it. So it's as it happens. Sometimes you get a shot and you think, wow, that's brilliant, but it's a little bit further away than I would have liked. I still have that size in the file to crop in and not lose the quality, which is great, and not had that before. And I have to say the quality of the images has really shocked me. I kind of didn't expect it to be the quality of the images to be that much better, but they are, they really are. Live view, big game changer. Now I did have that with the Olympus and I had a taste of it then. And when I went back to Nikon, I was like, oh man, I really do miss that live view, but it's brilliant. So I can now see in the viewfinder, the image I'm gonna capture in terms of its exposure. And for somebody, like I said, who forgets to breathe and forgets to change things sometimes, it allows me to see what's wrong and where I need. And so it reminds my brain all the time, change, change this, change, you know, and it's excellent. It's really helped me from a disability point of view and a personal point of view. It's really made things better for me. And then the other thing that I love, which people laugh at because they wonder what I'm doing. So I often pick up the camera on a shoot. I don't know if you can see me actually, so I won't do it. But I pick up the camera and I'm looking at the viewfinder, but the lens look is pointing to the sky. And they're like, what are you doing? But I'm reviewing the images through the viewfinder because for years I couldn't see the images on the back of the camera when I was out. So I'd have to put them under my jumper and look like I'm looking at my boobs to see what the picture looks like. But because I couldn't, because there was so much light glaring on it and stuff. Whereas now I just look at the viewfinder and I can see it. It sounds really, is that it? You know, is that what? But those things make such a huge difference when you're working, you know, in the middle of nowhere. So I love it. Two memory card slots is great if you're on really long shoots or if you're the kind of person who saves to two cards simultaneously. Battery life, very impressive. Now, my Olympus, I used to charge 7 batteries for my Olympus when I used to go out to do a wedding. And at least 4, if not more, to have on me in case of when I was doing a normal shoot for dogs and horses. Because if I'm in the middle of a field, I don't really have anywhere to plug anything in and I can't afford to run out of battery juice. So I've not once come near running out of a battery on my Sony on a shoot at all. I was really impressed with how advanced the kind of technology has moved on and battery life for the camera. Learning the new system for me, I'd say, was a bit of a fear factor because since my accident and developing the condition I have, learning new complicated things, especially written down, is quite a challenge, and remembering them. But actually wasn't as bad as I thought. And I picked it up quite quickly. And, you know, there's still a few bits that I forget where they are. But I think if you were unlike me, if you didn't have the condition and stuff that I have, you probably wouldn't forget them. And it's not as bad as I thought it was. And there's a lot out there. Mark has been brilliant. There's other photographers that shoot Sony that equally have helped out. So if there's something I think, oh, I know it does that, I just can't remember where, I just quickly ping them a message and they're very helpful. So working from a different perspective. Key thing for me as a pet photographer or an animal photographer, whichever way you look at it, is that, and it's something I think I've gained my reputation for, definitely with my clients and probably with quite a few people who've heard me speak, is I have this thing that understanding those that I work with is really important. And when I say those, I mean the animals that I work with is really important. Now, my biggest client group are horses and dogs. So they're the key areas of interest that I have. And I have literally over the 10 years dedicated a lot of myself and my time and stuff into learning about them. But I make a very clear point in saying it's not learning about training. So I have no interest in learning about training dogs or training horses or whatever. It is nothing to do with show world, body conformation, you know, all these breed standards. It's actually nothing to do with that. It is purely about a psychological and behavioral point of view. And it's something that's fascinated me anyway, but it's really, I feel for me, it's part of who I am naturally anyway. And I think the learning side of it has just escalated that bit higher. And it's what I think people often come to me for mainly because they know about the way I work. But so I did train. I did get to meet the man himself, Mr. Monty Roberts, and I did train alongside him. And I did spend the first 10 minutes just gawping at him because I was just so in awe of the fact that he was in the same room as me, let alone puts his arm around me there in that photo. He's an amazing individual. And in fact, if we looked at the way he sees the world and his relationship with horses, if we put that into our relationship with everything, even other human beings, the world would definitely be a better place. There's a lot of books you can read. The one I put there is The Other End of the Leash. It's a fascinating read. It's the one that talks a lot about, you know, we are primate, they are dogs, communication levels. So how we communicate to humans and how they communicate to each other are very different, and how our worlds have collided. And actually, it is really funny because in one of the part of the book, she says that, you know, if you watch the way you do something, that you do it all, you know, that you do regularly. Like I used to go and call Harvey from the dog run. And actually I started to watch the way I did things. And I stopped using words and just did the body language, and Harvey responded straight away. And it's fascinating when you see how much of us they learn and pick up. The Wolf Conservation Trust was a place where you could go and see the wolves. And I used to spend time there just watching them. People must have thought I was really weird, but I just wanted to watch them interact. That's all I wanted. And it was really fascinating, and it did teach me a lot. Sadly, you can't go there anymore. They've closed the public. I did my, like probably many people did, some online training during lockdown. So I got my diploma in canine behaviour training. Again, nothing to do with the training. It actually focused a lot around the kind of psychology and behaviour of dogs and the evolution of and how that's impacted them and stuff. But I'm always picking up things. I have a very close friend as a dog trainer, a behaviouralist. I've got loads of experience with obviously the work that I've done over the years and through life experience. And I've spent time at rescue centres sitting in front of a really aggressive dog's kennel, just waiting and watching and seeing how things work and stuff. And that won't stop. It's probably the most vital part of what I do alongside photography training is my constant dedication to learning more and more. And it comes to its own when you enter a situation like this. So at shows, I have marquee and I do some very quick portrait shots for people. And I saw this dog walking past at a show, and she was wearing about three collars, a harness, and she had a basket muzzle. So for people that don't know, basket muzzle is a really fixed, solid type, open weaved, but hard plastic muzzle. And when I see dogs like that, I'm really intrigued to know what's behind the story. So I spoke to the owner and they said, look, she's really bad. She was adopted. She came into foster with her sister and they then got adopted independently. Sister went to a great family, but sadly she was really, this dog was really badly abused and she had cigarettes stubbed out on her. She was beaten. And thankfully, somehow they managed to get her back. And this family had initially had fostered these two dogs before they went out for adoption, and they took her on. And she said, she's so reactive. And we're trying so hard bit by bit to actually sort of help her by socializing her, but we have to be really careful how we do it. And, you know, they're at this show and they were just always on the peripheral, sort of on the outside, just, you know, hovering. And I spoke to them for a while and I convinced them to come in and have a photo. And I got my assistant to actually just filter anyone away and come back later so that I could dedicate my time to her. And it took me a while to convince them to strip off the paraphernalia. So, you know, we got down to one collar and we took the harness off, and getting the muzzle off was really scary for them. But I just needed them to trust that I knew what I was doing. I wasn't going anywhere near this dog. I wasn't going to be teaching them anything. I wasn't training or anything. I just needed them to know that what I was doing was okay. And I showed them the picture on the back of my camera, and then I put this picture up on Facebook. And this is what they said. They said, hello, Maria, thank you so much for the beautiful picture of my baby girl. It made us so proud of her. And the fact that someone like yourself was willing to work with her, as so many will misjudge her on just what she looks like. She was so at ease when you took the photos. She even wanted to lay down, which is such a big sign for how comfortable she was around you in a noisy and foreign place. We cannot wait to receive her picture and hopefully we'll work with you again. That for me is, I guess, the epitome. It kind of, you know, if you had a description of why I do what I do, that's what it is. It's to know that people like that and dogs like that still can, you know, they can still have their beautiful photography, and somebody can see through all that paraphernalia and all that abuse and stuff to see what's behind it, and to see the relationships that they have. And they said that was the only photo they ever had of her without all the other crap on, you know, without the harness, the muzzle, the, you know, without the fear. And yeah, they cried when they saw the back of the camera. So it was a really special moment for me. And I always, when I'm, sometimes when I'm having like a really down day, I was like, I revert to that and think, you know what, Maria, that's what it's all about. So as I said to you before, the location is always significant to the client and their pets, which does mean that I'm usually quite often working in a new environment every time. Sometimes I go back to the same environment. Obviously, I have clients in similar areas and they walk in similar places. I think there's a place in Kent that I've been to about four times now. But it, you know, it could be anywhere. And sometimes it means traveling quite a few hours to get to that location. And it, that to me is really important, that it's still, you know, I could easily get them to a location I know, where I know everything's there, the lighting's gonna be a certain way in a certain time of day, da, da, da. But that kind of takes away from me the way I work. There's nothing wrong with it. Don't get me wrong. I'm not, you know, I don't mean that to sound disrespectful to anyone who does that. I'm just saying for me, that's not how I work. And during an average session, I could cover anything from 2, 3, maybe 4 miles as a minimum. I'm always on alert and constantly assessing the environment around me, because I need to be aware of what's going on around me that potentially could impact the shoot. I only use ambient light on location, because if I took to taking studio lights and stuff, it takes away that authenticity of that image. And remember, that's, for me, that's the key part, is that this image is more like capturing something very familiar that clients and animals experience together all the time. And by having to put studio lighting in and orchestrating where the dog goes and stuff, it kind of takes that away, and it takes away the flow. And I have very little interaction with these animals, so I don't want to do that. And I have to work with the challenges of sudden changes in light and with weather. I did a shoot last year and it was lovely. We were in this woodland and suddenly out of nowhere, it's like the end of the world was coming and the sky went really dark and we had the worst kind of monsoon type rain ever. And we were drenched. The dog was drenched. And I said to the owner, what do you want to do? She goes, well, just keep going. This is what we experience every day. You know, it's England, weather changes. So we've got these photos of this dog in the rain, and this dog was a black cockapoo, so it was really challenging for light as well. But actually the pictures of it in the rain are quite cool. They're really nice and the owner loved them. So at the start of a session, I always start by not interacting with the animals. People, you know, I love animals and yeah, nothing more better than to play with them, but I know it's completely the wrong way of working. By not interacting with them, it reduces the stress on them and it allows them to check me out, but with no pressure. And whilst doing all this, I always talk to my client at the beginning. I'll sit there and if I'm a lot of times I'll meet people, used to meet people at their home first before we go off to a location, we'll have a coffee. Or if we're at a location, we'll stand and we'll just talk for a bit. Because while we're doing that, I want to also be watching the animals and how they are. If we're at a yard and we're talking, I'm constantly watching what the horse is doing. If we're on a, you know, if we're with a dog, or on a location, again, just watching how they're responding to what's around them. So, you know, if something goes past, how they're gonna react or how they're reacting to us talking. And I get a lot of information from that. With dogs, I always put my bag on the floor and I just open, I unzip it and I let them sniff it. It's hardy equipment. It's, you know, there's, you know, I'm not letting them chew on it, but you know, I need to let them feel comfortable with it there. For horses, I definitely don't put it on the floor for obvious reasons. But I do introduce the camera to them. And before when I before I got the silent shutter one, obviously, I used to hold the camera near them and I would check what they'd be like with me shooting off near them. Because the last thing I want to do is find that out afterwards. And at all points, I'm explaining what I'm doing. So when I'm having a coffee with my client, I say, look, you know, I wanted to have a coffee with you and have a chat because it allows me to see what your animal's going to be doing in the background while we're doing this. Because it just lets me see how comfortable they are, you know, if there's things that I can see they're stressed a bit or anything like that. And that, and so they're always aware of what I'm doing and why. So attitude and behavior, it's something that I talk about a lot when I'm doing training, masterclasses and stuff. And I would really encourage people to think about is throughout the session, be it if I'm at a show in a studio environment, if I'm in a client's house, like in this picture when I was actually photographing a litter of puppies, not these, just these big dogs, I remain calm throughout the session. And it is something you have to practice because you cannot fake it. So remember that animals live by instinct. When we feel fear, nervousness, stress, we have an increase in adrenaline and cortisol. And actually, animals can sense those hormonal changes. We know that dogs can smell out cancer. We know that animals, horses, dogs, cats, everything, live on their instincts. That's what they need to survive. And so they can sense that there are these chemical changes, but they don't actually know why. They don't know, oh, that lady's a little bit afraid of big dogs. Or, you know, that lady's not sure because I'm being a bit, you know, this or that. They just know something's not right. And that puts them on edge. And it makes them, it can make them more nervous. It can make them more suspicious. So it's not healthy. You can't fake it. So you need to try and regain, to be comfortable around animals. And if you're not naturally, then work on that, because that is key to how you work. And being calm in a situation is vital. Equally, too much excitement can cause a lot of stress. I've heard a photographer saying, you know, at the beginning of a session, I love to play in the studio with the animals. And I'm like, right, okay, so you're in a stressful environment already, because studios are quite stressful. Even if you think that an animal is relaxed, studios are always more stressful, because there are, it's like when you take a dog or something to another house. Very few animals are completely comfortable with that. That you'll see they're a little bit more looking around. You can see the way, and if you learn to read their body language, you'll see little key signs of anxiety. Maybe not heightened stress, but anxiety. When you start to play with an animal in an environment like that, especially when you don't know them that well, sometimes they don't actually know what you want from them, you know, and they're not sure. And actually that can really cause a little bit more stress for them and anxiety. So it's better to keep your energy levels even, you know. Let the owners do the play part if that's part of what you're doing. If you're out, if I'm out and they want the dog, I want to get the dog running towards me, I let the owner do the calling back, you know. I don't do that myself. I let them do the heightened, woo, come, like that, you know, because I want the dog to do what they're comfortable with and you know, it doesn't impact them in a different way because it's me. So it's really key. Being calm is so important. If you're setting up equipment or taking down equipment like backdrops, lighting stands, soft boxes, again, I'm talking for me, that would only be a case for me if I'm in someone's home or in the studio. Please make sure the animals aren't around. I know that some animals are fine with it. I've also been told by photographers who've been bitten by a dog in particular, and they didn't know why. And it's very easy why. Because what you're doing can cause a reaction. And you may think that the animal's fine, but you may actually do something without realizing that startles or makes them react. Dogs have, you have to excuse the cat crying if you can hear it, I'm sorry. I've locked them out of my room and they're trying to break in. Even those that seem fine might react. Dogs have three options. It's called fight, flight, or fall around. Now, if you're in a room with a dog, the flight option has kind of been taken away from them. So now you've left them with fight or fall around. Now, you don't need to be getting a dog to a situation where they have to choose, because even a dog who would never dream of reacting by biting can be pushed to a situation where they feel they have to. And so even if they don't, but they're that stressed out, you shouldn't be causing that level of stress on an animal, especially not for photography. So you need to consider the fact that it's better for them just to eliminate that risk by keeping them out. So if you're setting up in someone's home, set up, go into the room, say hello to the client, do what you're going to do, but then go into that room alone or ask the client to keep the animals away while you set up. Let the animals come in and sniff the backdrop, sniff the stands and stuff like that. That's fine. But don't be taking it down and putting it up when they're in the room and there's all this commotion going on. Because you lift the stand up in the wrong way, dog doesn't know whether that's coming towards them or not, or towards their owner. So you've got to realize that there are so many different messages an animal sees in what you do than what you think you're giving out. Horses, their main option is flight. Okay, it is rare that a horse opts for fight. I'm not saying it's impossible and it does happen, but it's rare. So horses will just flight. A frightened horse running and in a flight mode is seriously dangerous. it's not only that it places other people at risk and you, but also other people around and the rider, if there's a rider on the back, but it also can cause serious risk to the horse and to other horses around if you're in a field where there's other horses, or to that horse itself. If it's running in panic, it's not going to see a wire fence, like a barbed wire fence, or it might even see a fence, but it'll try and clear it. And it may do itself a lot of harm, or even just running through the field and it hits a little hole in the ground. Because it's in panic mode, there is so much potential for harm to come to that horse and to people around it. You have to be really careful. So it's important at all times to monitor animals' behavior throughout your session. That's why I said earlier that I'm always really observant of what's in front of me, as in my client, their animal, but what's going on around me. So I keep my interactions on location with them to a minimum, like I do in the house or in a studio. The last thing I want is a dog to want to play with me, because it's a bit pointless. And also because they're going to be so bloody close to my camera, I can't get a shot of them. And so the least interesting I am, the better. I have had a horse. I was in a field with a herd of horses once, finishing off a shoot, and I had one unzipping my backpack. The other one was licking my camera lens. So they clearly had got a bit too familiar with me at that point. Throughout the session, I always stay alert. Now, I was talking about this now. The looking for the signs of animal getting stressed is key. This horse in this picture had been introduced to a light stand previously, and it was fine, didn't care. Did a couple of shots, fine. Then we moved to a menage, and it was like I'd brought something completely different into the menage. It was like this whole new, oh my God, what is that? And it's the same thing. But horses, you know, different, same thing, different environment. Suddenly it's like the, you know, like the devil reincarnated. So you've got to watch all the time for these signs. Staying alert around you is really key, because there are changes and there are things that happen in the environment that can have a big impact on your shoot, but also on the animal that you're working with. So for me, it's normally cows and deer. Or muntjac near me. So I'll be in the middle of a shoot and something just whizzes past. Some of the forests that we have here have open grazing for cattle. And when you get like a whole herd of cattle coming in, like, you know, it's about 100 cattle coming through past you and they are big, you know, you don't want the dog running around like a yo-yo doing his own thing and sending them off into a crazed run. But it's things like you can get a cyclist coming past that can really freak a horse out or could cause some dogs to just head out and chase it. So it's important. And if you do your homework beforehand, which is what I do, and get like this booking form filled in, you know that you should know, or hopefully they've told you that this animal have a high prey drive, this horse is quite skittish or reactive around certain things. And that information needs to stay with you, because on a shoot, you're going to be looking out for that. And also, not going to lie, other people's animals, I've had other people's dogs running to a shoot before, you know. And whilst two dogs may be the friendliest dogs in the world, together they may clash, not because they're aggressive, but because they just don't get on, them two together. And so you're always aware of what's around you. And if you're working with elderly or unwell pets, you need to adapt the way you work accordingly, like you would for humans. If you're working with a dog who's got severe hip dysplasia, for example, some breeds of dog like Harvey and Wilson, who we've got now, they're the kind of dogs that will push through pain because they want to do what they're doing. But it means they still suffer for it later. Not Wilson, because he hasn't got a problem, but Harvey did. He had hip dysplasia. So if you know that, you're gonna allow for breaks where you just stop with the client, have a chat, and the dog will usually stop and lay down somewhere nearby. And then you go off and walk again. Because all that running around that they do naturally on their own is still an impact on their joints. So, you know, you adapt the way you work to cater for those animals and for their needs and your client. Remember, horses are prey animals and dogs are hunters. They are very different, but all animals rely on their instincts and senses such as smell, sound, and sight, and all of which are far more acute than ours. Trust me, a dog will smell a rabbit miles before you even see a glimmer of it. Some dogs will just dart off and you think, what is going on? You know, and they've picked up a scent. It depends on that dog. It depends on whether they're scent driven. Wilson at the moment is going through hormonal changes and he's very scent driven at the moment. So, you know, all these things that come into play. And on a shoot, if you're near a railway line or you're near a road, that can be quite dangerous. So these things come into play all the time. So why do we shoot this way? Why shoot this way? Surely it's easier to stick them in a studio, control the lighting, get the shots, be done with. Well, animals are far more in a more familiar setting, and so therefore they're far more likely to be relaxed. And when I say relaxed, I don't say they don't get excited and stuff, because they do, because they're doing what they do every day. And if that's what they do, if they're excitable, you know, say the excitable dogs love whizzing around smelling things, that's what they're going to do. But what I mean by that is that there's no additional stress or anxiety factor coming into play. They're so busy doing what they do, right? The studio environment can be very stressful for animals, even those that seem to be okay, but are often actually still showing signs, subtle signs of anxiety. Many, many people miss these signs. I see them because it's something that I'm tuned into. I've spent years learning about it, and I do this day in, day out. But it's really important, if you're going to work towards being a specialist pet photographer, that you put value in that as well, because we should not be placing animals under additional stress for photography. It's just not. You wouldn't do it to a child. You know, if a child was crying its heart out, traumatized in a studio, you go, oh, just, you know, we'll just carry on shooting because we're going to get a great shot. You just wouldn't do it. It's unethical. So we shouldn't be doing it to animals who who we can't even explain to what's going on properly. Working on location allows animals to behave more naturally. Like I said, I have had the puppy that sat and didn't do anything, and that was challenging. But, you know, eventually we got some nice shots, just probably not as many as another shoot where the animal is lively and whizzing around. It enables me to capture things that happen every day in the life shared between the client and their pets. And obviously for me, the way I work, that's key. It also enables me to capture images that clients can immediately connect with. So that familiarity, that subconscious familiarity that we talked about earlier. And it enables me to capture a greater variety of images, because most of my clients buy albums along with wall art. They're not getting one, two, maybe five images. The average gallery that I have is anything from 20 to 40 images. And to be honest with you, if I'm really honest, it gives me a good excuse to roll around in mud. And I do like doing that. So that's that. And now I'm going to show you a slideshow to music of just a collection of different images taken over the last few years, some last year, possibly some not this year, no, last year and a few years before that, to give you a general idea of the kind of images that I get, and to kind of give you an actual physical example of how all this comes into play to create these images. And Colin, if you're good to go, please.
Maybe I'm foolish, maybe I'm blind, thinking I can see through this and see what's behind. Got no way to prove it, so maybe I'm lying. But I'm only human after all, I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me, don't put your blame on me. Take a look in the mirror, what do you see? You see it clearer, or are you deceived in what you believe? 'Cause I'm only human after all, and you're only human after all. Don't put the blame on me, don't put your blame on me. Some people got the real problems, some people out of love, some people think so now, Lord, heavens above. I'm only human after all, I'm only human after all. Don't put the blame on me, don't put the blame on me. Don't ask my opinion, don't ask me to lie, and beg for forgiveness for making you cry, for making you cry. 'Cause I'm only human after all, I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me, don't put the blame on me. Oh, some people got the real problems, some people out of love, some people think
I'm just going to go through this very quickly. I know we're running short on time, but it all boils down to what does this mean for the client? So how does this feel from a client's perspective? Because we are service providers. We provide a service to clients, and without them, we wouldn't have, well, I wouldn't have a business really. But it's important for me that I know that my clients, that the amount of effort and time and dedication that I put into this is actually, I'm doing the right thing. And I'm actually achieving what I'm hoping I'm trying to achieve, because if I'm not, then I need to change what I'm doing. But I'm hoping that it comes across. And my client, I've got one client, I've got a few, but I'm not going to go through all of them. I'm just going to go through this one key one, which is the feedback that a client gave me, which actually made me cry when I read it. So sad. Must be having a bad day. But no, it literally just solidifies everything that I work so hard for in this feedback. So the dog's name was Tikani, which is really weird because in Greek means Tiganis, means how are you or what are you doing? But that isn't apparently what she's called after. It's some, I don't know what it means, something else. But my client said, so I met these clients at a dog show and they bought a voucher. So they said, from the moment that we met Maria, we knew we would get the perfect pictures, the perfect images of our girl. We were more than just another customer to give out a leaflet to. She really took time to speak to us about our dog and what sort of photographs we wanted. All this before we had even made a booking with her. The best part, Maria cares deeply about the welfare of the animal she's photographing. Our dog was allowed to do as she would normally do with no pressure for poses. And it was Maria that worked around the dog, not the other way around. I particularly remember the moment that she lay in a puddle to get a certain angle of Tikani happily galloping through puddles. Her approach to the whole session was so relaxed and based around the dog that we were so at ease. We ended up on what is a normal walk for us and our dog, which consequently led to capturing the most natural shots of our beautiful girl in the surroundings we have an actual connection with, rather than a random location or studio that doesn't hold any special memories for us. We got images in the shoot that we never dreamed about. The one with the stick in the water springs to mind here, alongside classic shots of moments we know and love every day. A true combination of everything you could ever ask for in one session. And that's the shot she mentions where I'm laying in a puddle to photograph Tikani jumping another puddle. And I was filthy because it was really muddy. Once the photos had been edited and we were invited to the viewing and ordering session, which was a very enjoyable experience. When it came to ordering, there was absolutely no pressure on us to buy anything. This was made clear from the beginning, which set us at ease from the start. We bought the products that we did because we wanted to and we loved Maria's work. There was no obligation to get anything, but we were stunned with the quality of everything that there was. So there was no way we were not going to order. And that's the image she references in terms of the image with the stick in the water.
Maria, is the slideshow supposed to be on again?
Is it not on?
No, after the video, you closed the share screen.
Share screen. Sorry, guys.
That's okay.
I'm really not on the ball, am I? Where's my share screen? Oh, there it is. Oh, I was doing so well then. I'll just take you to the images because you don't need. Oh, it's doing that again. Hang on.
That's okay. Just while you're pulling that up, just again a quick reminder: if anybody wants to submit any last minute questions, we've got quite a few to get through. But if anybody wants to submit any more questions, now's the best time to put them in the comments, and we'll get to them after Maria's completed the presentation. So now's your best time. Okie dokie, okay. That's you back up, and I'm going to hide myself again.
Thank you,
Maria.
Sorry about that, everyone. So anyway, you didn't miss any photos, just me reading the writing that the clients had put. But this is the photo she mentions with me jumping over Tikani's jumping over the puddle, and I'm laying in the other one. So this is the discussion around the viewing and ordering session. And this is the album that they purchased on the left. And the picture she makes reference to with the dog in the water with the stick, that they bought that as a wall piece. And I believe they took a collection, one of my collections, that has both wall art and album. I cannot thank Maria enough for her kindness, sincerity, and amazing ability to capture the true nature of all that she photographs. I'm proud and honored to have her work adorn our house. And I have love showing off our album to people I know. I always beam with joy when they flick through the pages and comment on how happy our girl looks and how beautiful the images are. The album also doubles up as a photo frame, meaning it can be displayed at all times. And the quality is fantastic. Bright and gorgeous images captured in quality material in the color of our choice, encased in a box that is not only stylish, but also protective with a magnetic clear front to proudly display the front image. Thank you, Maria, for putting a bit of your heart and soul into every photo and product and moment. from Amy, Mike, Takani, proud clients of Dethea Photography. Now, for me, it was that last bit that I read about putting your heart into everything you do that kind of brought me to tears, because that is exactly what I do. And that's me. I'm a passionate person. You know, if I'm doing something, I have to do it 110%. But when you've spent this many years trying to learn and so much and put it into practice to achieve something, Takani is a lovely dog, but she is nervous. And so to know that we achieved so much at that shoot, and to know that that was their experience of the shoot, it meant so much to me. And again, like I say, it reminds me why I do what I do and the way I do it. The next one's about another, I won't go through this, but again, it's two dogs. The one on the one lower down, Fen, had been diagnosed with kidney disease, and Rupert, who's one jumping, had some heart issues, and they were given both about 2 months to live. Their owners are vets. And they called me up, they'd seen my work through a friend, and the friend recommended me, and I literally squeezed them in. It was really hard, but I adjusted loads of stuff to get them squeezed in within a couple of days. And we went and did this shoot, and this picture not only hangs in their house, but about a few months ago, sadly, Fen died last year, 2 years after the shoot, by the way. These dogs actually, and Rupert's still going. So thankfully these dogs did survive, but Fen did pass away last year. And so my client purchased another copy of this image to hang in her partner's surgery, in his veterinary practice, because they work in different practices, because it meant so much to them. And again, it just reminds me that those images that we capture are so important. So these are some contact details of me, Facebook, website, Instagram. A thank you gift from me for anyone who's looking to do professional training one-to-one, be that via online facilities or face-to-face. If you contact me before the end of June this year, you don't have to get your session booked in before then, but if you just contact me to arrange it for the upcoming year, then you will get 20% off by quoting Dethea21. And that's it from my presentation side. So I will stop sharing this, I think, if I can remember how to do it.
Amazing. Yeah, that's all sorted. We've removed it from the stream.
I can't see anything now.
That's okay. We'll have a chat while you're reconfiguring your computer. But, you know, it's such a fantastic webinar. Thank you so much for today. It really shows the passion that you have for pet photography, not just from the, you know, the amazing pictures you take, but the way you work with animals, you know, and that comes across as, you know, so powerfully throughout the presentation. It really does. We have loads of questions to get through. I'm not 100% sure we will get through them all. We've got so many in there.
Okay.
But before we jump onto the questions, there's loads of people interested in the mirrorless stuff. So I'm sure between you and Mark, you'll be able to answer all the questions perfectly. But Mark, you've managed to arrange some fantastic offers for everyone watching today as part of the supported by elements of the webinar that you're doing for us through Sony.
Yeah, thanks, Connie. Maria, thank you ever so much again. Superb on the spot. And I really enjoyed that. So thanks again. As we said off air, I can't wait to get back to physical workshops and trade shows and stuff like that. So it'd be great to work with you on stuff like that in the future. Yes. So when we're doing these types of events, we do them with our retailers as well. And thank you to London Camera Exchange for their support. So it's very basically an honest, open chat here that if you are interested in buying Sony gear, there are no specific offers here that are applicable, like 20%, 30% offer or anything like that. Please let Colin know directly if you are interested and you have something to trade in and so on, then Colin will pass your details over to me and we can do something with you on an individual basis alongside the London Camera Exchange. But running nationwide at the moment, we have basically, if you've bought a product recently and or you're just about to, make sure you register your product with this website here, because you could be entitled to additional money off. And also something free, not much out there free these days, but if you have purchased something or you're just about to, or over the next year up until January next year, we're giving away 1 year extended warranty on top of what the retailer's giving on top of our 12-month warranty. So register your product with this website at the bottom of the page and you're entitled to it. It's about £40, so you get it for free. And again, two more offers. One, you can do a combination of the Zeiss kit, 55 mil, 1.8 with the A7 III, cracking deal, £250 saving there. And if you're looking for a smaller compact lens as well, the 28-60, which we released last year with the A7C, the little compact full frame camera, you can save £180 as well. And then back to me. There we go.
Amazing. So, you know, if anybody wants to take advantage of any of those offers or, you know, want some more details, then please post in the comments and I will forward your details on to Mark so he can contact you directly. Some fantastic savings there on some amazing kits. So, you know, do consider that. And of course, Maria's fantastic offer of one-to-one training. So, you know, check that one out as well. Well, going to be well worth it. I know there's quite a few people tuned in that are looking into taking pet photography more on board in their business, you know, so now's the time to invest in that training and get ready for when everything reopens. Some people have tuned in halfway through. Don't worry, this is available on catch up on the Society's Facebook page, our YouTube channel, and on our website, thesocieties.net. So if you've tuned in halfway and missed the first half, don't worry, you can watch the replay. Or, of course, if you just want to watch it again to take more notes, then you can do that as well. So there we go. Now on to the questions. We do have quite a few, so we will rattle through them as quick as we can. David Goodyear has joined on, and he is looking to add pet photography to his business. So he's got quite a few questions, so we'll try and go through the majority of his first. So thank you, David, for your questions. Really great to see so many coming in. So his first one is, as mirrorless is what you see is what you get, do you need to shoot RAW or is high quality JPEG good enough? Who wants to answer that one?
I think they probably want to hear more from the professional photographer, but I'll give you the tech spec at the end.
Okay. I will say from my point of view, hi David, thanks for joining us. Thanks for all your questions. I've actually just seen now. I've just found the comments section. That's so
sad. I did as well.
But right, thank you so much. It's lovely to know that people take an interest. I shoot RAW, and I don't shoot RAW because of my concept isn't because of what, you know, quality. It's because the reality aspect is when you're working on location, it's a little bit like, you know, I don't have the control of, you know, moving things and adjusting things because it's all free flow work. So I need to have that the best image quality to start with because I'm going to edit. You know, people used to edit in a dark room. It's not they didn't edit. I don't know why people think we did. So there's nothing wrong with shooting in RAW and editing. That's what pros do. So don't feel uncomfortable in that. But if you want to shoot JPEG, I've shot JPEG on my camera. They're amazing, but I wouldn't choose as a general rule to edit on JPEG. So I suppose for me, it's just habitual that I shoot in RAW. But I'm sure Mark can tell us the technical side of it because I would not tell you the technical side of it. What do you think?
I won't bore people with tech. But the fact is, obviously, if you're using a Sony mirrorless camera, more of the latest ones like you've got, Maria, then they've got two card slots. So you can actually shoot one card RAW, one card JPEG, one card RAW and JPEG, and another video and so on. So you can customize it to how you want it. Of course, it's going to take a lot of memory. So you need one of the fastest cards that are available in the marketplace. That will obviously fit. That's SD cards as well, but you can shoot compressed or uncompressed. And I know a lot of wedding photographers that we've worked with over time in the last few years shoot compressed RAW. There is a slight level of detail change, but not massively. But obviously, it allows you to shoot longer, and it doesn't fill the card up as much. So, loads of opportunities. But the fact is, with what you see, what you get, which is what the technology is, David, you said, you know, it doesn't matter if it's RAW or JPEG, you'll see it in the viewfinder, whether or the back of the screen. So, I think the message there is you've got a lot of customization, whether you want to or not. So,
perfect. We will move on to David's next question, which is, some of my wedding couples bring their dogs. I screech, meow, bark to try and get them to look at me when they are in a shot. Any tips for getting a dog's attention is appreciated.
Okay. It's a little bit embarrassing, this one. Firstly, actually, let me just say, when you're at a wedding and you've got a dog there, it's harder because there's so much going on around the dog, and there's so many, even when you think it's calm and quiet, the smells, the foreign environment, your venue or whatever, that in itself is another additional component in the dog's brain. And so, and if you ever learn about stressed animals, especially dogs when they're nervous or frightened, they go through a series of clamp down sort of thing. A really, really anxious dog won't take a treat. you know, they completely start to shut down. So when your dog, even my own dog, if he's unsure about something, treats are irrelevant, you know, doesn't matter how tasty they are, you know, he's focused on that. So at a wedding, that can be a bit harder. As a child, I always wanted a dog when I was little, and my mum wouldn't let me get one really badly. So this is really sad. I'm saying this in public. I'm sorry, everybody. I'm sorry to my mother. Thank gosh I had the internet. I learned to bark like a dog. So I used to walk home from school, primary school, and I used to bark. And mum goes, oh, you always knew you were coming because you're barking all the way. But I learned to cry like a dog. I don't know if I can do it now. But so when I'm shooting, I wait till I'm ready. Especially if I'm doing this in the market, this is mainly if I do it shows, not on location. If I'm on my show and I want to get that head tilt, so I'm ready to go. I know the camera's ready. I know the dog's in kind of the position I'm going to get it in. And I go, and you get that. And that's it. But you do that twice, three times, it's finished. Not going to look at you again. So some people have apps that do noises, but I'd say your issue is more to do with the environment. And at a wedding, it's really hard, but take more time in terms of give the dog chance to settle. So if you're going to go and take a shot over there with the bride and groom, take them over there, let them hang around there with the dog, and then get them into position. Because the dog needs time to just get used to that environment and what's going on around them first before they can relax.
Amazing. Perfect. We'll jump straight on to his next question, which is, I love dogs, dislike horses, and can't stand cats. Is it best to only work with animals you like?
Yes, there's no need to dance around that. Don't work with anything that you don't like. They are not silly. They can sense things. And you need to know about the animals you're working with. And if you don't like them, that's a little bit pointless. So stick to what you like. It makes life easier anyway. Nice, better work environment.
Brilliant. I was just trying to find out who asked this question. Apologies, your name didn't come through the software. But Maria, have you ever had to take charge of an animal during a shoot when an owner hasn't taken control in a potentially dangerous situation? Is there a line that shouldn't be crossed as a photographer?
Yes. Okay. So in my contract, it very clearly states that the owner of this animal, the client, is responsible for the behaviour of the animal on the shoot. I actively will look out for things like, if I know this dog's reactive, I'll look out for other dogs, stuff like that. If an incident occurs, I'm not going to stand back and go, well, it's nothing to do with me, sorry. But if I feel that an owner is not taking responsibility or not doing what they need to do from a safety point of view, then I will ask them or instruct them in a way that doesn't come across offensive to do that. If something is actually beyond acceptable, I would stop my shoot, okay? That is my, I'm the expert here. I'm the professional who's doing a job. And I cannot allow that to continue with the risk of something going wrong. Now, I had a dog once fall in a lake. I was behind the camera. I didn't even know it was going to happen. I was about to take the shot, and this little Yorkshire Terrier fell off this platform and landed in the middle of this giant lake pond thing. And the client jumped in and got stuck in the lake. Her shoes wedged at the bottom. So I had to go in and get her out. Now, it was hysterical, it was funny, whatever. That is fine. But if I can see that my client's being really irresponsible, so this dog's chasing people or something like that, and they're not doing anything, I'd stop the shoot. Because I know better than to allow that to continue. Take charge of an animal. I've had to grab onto a dog before, as in grab onto, you know, I know they're going to run around and stuff, and they're not, you know, running around in a way where they're likely in an aggressive way. So I might just say, oh yeah, you know, come on, so-and-so, you know. But, or maybe help a client if they're trying to put the jacket on and they've got a lead. Yeah. But no, they're not your pet. They're not your pet. You are, even if you've met them before, there's clients I've worked with maybe three times, but I'm not their dog's owner. So they don't have that same connection with me. You have to be careful. Because if a dog bites you, 9 times out of 10, it's something you've done that's caused that reaction, but it has huge legal implications. That dog, in theory, could be put to sleep because of that. If you made a formal complaint, that could happen. You then changed the feeling and the interaction, the bond between client and dog, because they now think, shit, I've got a dog that can bite. I don't think my dog would do that. They're not thinking, well, actually, Maria did that by accident, that actually made the dog bite. That's not how people think. And I've seen situations, not in work, but outside of my photography world, where people have had their dogs destroyed because they've bitten someone, but no one stopped to ask why. So it has. It's not your job to take control of the dog. Yes, if you're going to help in an emergency, but if you feel the situation's going that way, you need to take control and say, I'm sorry. Either you put this dog on lead, we'll carry on with it on lead and we edit that out later, or we have to stop this session. The one time I stopped the session was a dog who was really, really stressed. And I told these people that a studio shoot was not appropriate and they insisted. And I love them to be lovely clients, but they'd paid for two shoots. One as a studio and one was outdoors. And I warned them this German Shepherd would be too stressed. And in the shoot, he was really stressed to the point where the couple were arguing. And the dog was getting even more and more stressed because they were arguing, which made it worse. And I said, right, enough. Out we come. Out. And I showed you guys my log cabin studio. Out we come to the studio. We're going for a walk. This dog cannot, and during that walk, I said, this dog cannot cope being in a studio. It's unethical to do this for a nice photo. I can get you a nice photo out here. What's more important, your dog's welfare or a photo that you've got an image of in your head? So no, you need to take control and say no, enough's enough. But be careful about physically intervening with other people's animals. Just be careful.
Yeah, that's a good point. And something else you mentioned was, you know, like the actions we have as, you know, as when we're working can have massive implications in the end. Yeah, so and that goes across a broad spectrum of things, but it was just something I picked out of your comment there. So yeah, very good points. We'll go back to David. That was from James, that comment. So thank you very much, James, for the question. David's asking, how many hours are you suggesting for an environmental dog shoot, and how many images from the hundreds or thousands you shoot do you show?
Okay. How many hours? Photographers vary. Some photographers have a clear cut. We do an hour and a half session or whatever. I don't do that because I, over the years, have built up this sort of, I don't know, we call it reputation or whatever, or people know me for working with a lot of nervous or reactive animals. And sometimes I might spend 20 minutes, half an hour desensitizing an animal, be it a horse or a dog, to my camera equipment or to just me being around. So I don't really put a time limit on mine. I tell my clients to allow at least 2 hours. But it might not be that, might be an hour. But, you know, I like them to not have plans beyond that that makes them feel rushed and anxious about things. As for how many you shoot, again, it really varies if I'm working with two dogs, three dogs, you know, one dog. But an average client will receive, will see anything from 20 to 40 images roughly. And all the images are edited and on a slideshow like the one we just played. That's what they get. That's how they see their images for the first time when they're coming into the room for a viewing and ordering session.
Perfect. Shirley is asking, do you always use handheld?
Yeah, 100%. We are never in one place more than a millisecond. So I can't do it on a tripod because I'd be carrying a tripod around 4 miles of landscape. It's not going to happen. And the positions I'm getting, no tripod is going to go there. So, yeah.
Always handheld. Perfect. James is asking, any tricks in getting both horses' ears up at the same time? Any noises you can share? Is it the same as the dog one you did before?
Don't do that. That doesn't work. To be honest with you, horses use, because they're so, right, because horses are prey from a kind of evolution point of view. You know, locating sound is really important because you need to know what's going on around you. Especially because it's too long with this going to, but anyway, so when I trained with Monty, he talked about, you know, the vulnerability of a horse from behind and its back and stuff. So the ear location is quite a natural thing, you know, because they're listening all the time. Keys, a lot of photographers use keys. I sometimes jangle keys, so I can remember where I've put them. I might just tap my camera with my nails, you know, different things like that. Get the owner to say something. And sometimes about time, just about patience, about just giving time, and it will happen. I don't have a problem with ears locating sound somewhere else because I know that's what horses do naturally. And this is where I say to people, just remember why you're doing what you're doing. Everyone seems to want this shot. And yeah, I know it looks nice, but the other shot isn't wrong. And the owner does recognize that other shot and does see it very frequently. Okay, so don't get so preoccupied in the end image having to conform to this ideal that isn't actually based even on a reality, because that image isn't the all the time image. That and that and that is what happens. So yeah, keys.
Perfect. Vicky is asking two questions, so we'll double them up. Okay. So hi Maria, what editing software do you use? And then the follow-up question, what computer do you use, either Apple Mac or PC kind of thing?
Okay. I use a very, 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 very old Mac, which needs to be updated, but I haven't had a chance yet. Don't get me wrong, you can use, honestly, for me, it's because of the way my brain is. My watch, my phone, my iPad, my laptop, and my computer all talk to each other. It makes life easier for someone who has memory problems and stuff, that when I'm on the go and I've picked up my laptop and I'm at the convention, for example, that I still see the same things. And, you know, it's not, but you don't need to have a Mac to edit. You can do it on any, on Windows or whatever. I use Photoshop. So I have my card is uploaded straight onto Lightroom. And I do my whole starring system. I go through them big, choose the ones I like, give them a 5-star, and they're the ones I'm going to look at later on. I do minor tweaks in Lightroom, and then I do my main work in Photoshop. I'm old fashioned. I do things a bit the slow way, but I'm a control freak, so I like that.
Amazing. David is asking, is there a more saleable composition rather than i.e. thirds or more arty compositions? My go-to thoughts are for central, by the way. So compositions.
I tend to shoot more landscape than portrait. I will say that. Partly maybe that's because of physically or just the way I am. But I do actually make a point of trying to get some portrait shots from a saleable point of view, because some clients have these, you know, have images they want to put in particular places, and that portrait shot works better. But to be honest with you, in terms of composition, because I'm a do it as I feel it kind of person, it is literally as I feel it. So I don't really aim for stuff, if that makes any sense.
Cool. Yeah, makes sense. Brilliant. Shirley was asking, do you use manual mode?
Yes, in the studio or on a shoot at the shows, but not on the majority of my work. So I shoot aperture priority. I am working too fast to be messing around all the time. So as long as I know that my camera is going to be stuck at usually, let's say 2.8, 4, something like that, you know, then I know that the rest, but I always make sure to set my ISO to a rate that it's going to accommodate the change in light, so that my shutter speed is always fast enough, because it has to be a certain speed to capture that movement.
Brilliant. Fantastic. I hope I'm going to say this name right. Odalis, I hope I'm saying that right. It's a fantastic question. If you could time travel to the beginning of your career and could tell yourself one shortcut that would save you years of struggle other than gear, what advice would you give yourself? Brilliant question.
Okay. I don't know if this is in the realm of what they're thinking, but for me, I think I tell myself that actually learn to appreciate what you do for what you do. Don't keep comparing yourself to everybody, and don't allow. So I love competitions, but sometimes it's really easy that we all get to this point where we think that if we're not winning a gold or an award, that we must not be producing good work. And that's not true. Learn that there is competition work and there is client work, and they both can be equally phenomenal, but they don't necessarily always work for each other. I remember shooting the most stunning wedding picture ever when I was doing wedding photography, and my clients brushed it over like it didn't exist. And I was heartbroken. I was like, oh my God, that should be like wall mountable, like the biggest print you could get. They didn't see anything in it. And it's the same in what I do. I now only shoot for the way that I work, and then sometimes see, oh, that might work in competition. But I don't shoot for competition because my brain doesn't have time to think about that as well, but I don't often have time for it. But put value in what you do for the reason you do it. I spent a lot of time doubting myself, and actually that doubt has huge implications in the way you run a business. So yeah, that'll be my big thing for me.
Brilliant. We'll try and quick fire these because I know we are running out of time. So David Goody is asking, so if totally new to shooting dogs, how would you recommend to get started?
I'm going to have to say training, I'm afraid. But again, it's, you know, training, yes, but hands-on training, that's hard. If you've got dogs, great, but don't tell me you've got dogs and you know everything, because obviously that doesn't work. So you need to start getting experience around dogs. So learn about, do just a little bit of dog psychology / behavior training, whether it's online, it doesn't have to be anything intense, and then start looking at incorporating that in, because that is, before anything else, that's the key thing that you need to have. It's the foundation level of what you're going to do.
Perfect. Jane's asking, I don't know if Mark wants to answer this or pass it on to Maria. So Jane's asking, I've recently bought the A7 Mark IV, I think, and have some good A-mount lenses I can't afford to replace yet. What is the adapter I'd need, please?
Depends on the lenses that Jane's got. So there are two. There's actually three. There's the LA-EA3. There's the LEA, EA3, EA4, and a new version, the EA5, and they vary between £200 and £270. If the A-mount lens glass has got a technology like, if the body's got face detection and so on in the lens, then they'll want the one that has that, which is a little box at the bottom of the adapter. But it will allow you to use the glass on the E-mount. If you're using, say, for example, Maria's A9, your frame rate will drop just because the technology doesn't make the handshake in certain ways. But other than that, you can bring all your glass over and use them. You don't lose any quality. They'll still perform as well as they did on your A-mount body.
Awesome. Thank you very much for that, Mark. We'll go for one last question off Kirsty. So Kirsty is asking, can you pull back detail in post-production with RAW?
Yeah, you can. I mean, with like any RAW image, I mean, look, you aim to get it right as much as possible in camera. That's the reality of it, okay? But there are times when, you know, something's a bit brighter than you wanted it to be, you know, but you kind of like when you're working that fast and the camera's, you know, trying to assess all these changes all the time, you know, something might give a bit. But if you're going to blow it completely, it's going to blow. You can't, there's only so much you can pull back. I guess I'd say I used to shoot a little bit darker than I wanted to allow that. I think the biggest challenge when you shoot, when you're working with a dog like a collie, if it's a classic black and white collie, it's a nightmare. It's like, you know, it's like a bride and groom with a white dress and dark out suit or something, you know. They're the ones that obviously when the light's changing every 2 minutes because of cloud cover and stuff, it can cause you difficulties. But yeah, I mean, you can always aim this idea that, well, if I shoot raw, I can do anything. No, that doesn't work like that. So you need to aim to do it as best as possible in camera. And then, yes, you can then draw back a few bits when you're working in RAW. Definitely more so than you'll ever do in JPEG, I would say, from my point of view. I might be wrong, but that's what I'm thinking.
Brilliant. Awesome. I'm going to finish this webinar, and it's been a fantastic webinar. It really has. So thank you so much to Maria for providing the webinar, to Sony and London Camera Exchange for supporting this webinar. It's been really, really interesting, and I'm looking forward to doing more with you guys in the not too distant future. But I'm going to pull up one last comment from Chris Miller, because it's a lovely comment, and he just said, just a quick comment, Maria's one-to-one training is so valuable. It really helped me focus on the right things, particularly on the business and identifying our perfect client. It saves so much time finding the right suppliers to Graphy and the Print Foundry. Highly recommended. So I just wanted to pull that up because it was such a lovely comment to finish the webinar off when it's been such a fantastic webinar. And again, if you've tuned in halfway, don't worry, it's available on the catch-up, on the Societies of Photographers page, on our YouTube channel, and the societies.net. So that leaves me to say a massive thank you again to you, Maria, to Sony, London Camera Exchange, and thank you all for tuning in. It's been a fantastic webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks
for having
me. Thanks, Colin. Thanks, Maria.
And hopefully we'll see you all soon in person, hopefully.
Let's hope so. Yes, definitely. Thank you so much again, and we'll speak to you all soon.
Bye-bye.